by Danny Medina from Brighton, Colorado. A capacity crowd is on hand here in the Cotillion Ballroom at Resorts International. The showplace like no place. And when you talk about the Cotillion Ballroom at Resorts International, it is a room that has played host to Luciano Pavarotti, Julio Iglesias, to name just a couple. Well, the rules here for the nine-ball championship, you've got to get that nine ball in some pocket. But before you can do that, you've got to be shooting at the lowest numbered ball on the table. Player shoots until he or she misses. The game is over naturally when that nine ball goes down. And if at any time a player fouls, he immediately loses his turn. First player to win nine games wins the match. It is Mike Siegel in the foreground. Danny Medina is partially hidden. At the bottom of your screen, it is Siegel, as they will lag for the right to break. Ball that comes closest to that end rail will lag, and it is going to be Medina who will have the break here in game number one. Medina lost earlier in this tournament.
Is this it, I think? Check it. Yeah, I think so.
Jose Garcia.
Look at mine.
Medina will try and win this match to stay alive in the chase for the top prize of $40,000. I'm Phil Stone along with Jack Johnson. And Jack, it is the richest tournament in the history of pocket billiards.
$40,000 first prize. It's the largest cash prize that's ever been in a pool tournament. I might add, we've drawn the largest crowds that have ever been, spectator crowds ever been for a pool tournament also, Phil.
Now, when you talk about Danny Medina, you're talking about a man, Jack, who explodes the balls on the break.
He has the best break in pool today. But these balls are actually going to leave the table.
Now, Nick Barner was telling me earlier in this tournament that this table is a very slow table compared to the other tables that were used earlier in this tournament. What's he talking about?
Well, the cloth is brand new, so therefore it's a new cloth. And there's a lot of friction between the ball and the cloth because so much nap on the cloth. And it causes the balls to move slowly. It takes more of a powerful stroke to move the cue ball around the table in order to play position. And the balls don't fly around the table on the break, and they just don't fly in. This creates slower play all around. Mike Siegel's got a relatively difficult layout here. One of Mike's problems is this 4-8 connection here. These balls are tied up, which creates tremendous difficulty in running out. He's trying to shoot the two balls in the corner pocket right now. In the side pocket, excuse me.
Well, he didn't make the shot, but he left Danny Medina with a very, very difficult shot.
And Mike's trying to cut the ball into the side pocket. He just barely misses off the lip. Okay, Danny's got a kick at this ball. Remember, if he does not hit the ball and make good contact, he must be able to nip this ball just a little bit here. If he doesn't make contact with the ball and drive a ball to the rail, Mike will receive the cue ball in hand. He can place it anywhere on the table. He's going to size it up. It doesn't seem like he can hit this ball. He's going to have to, like, try to attempt to kick at this ball two rails.
Medina, 35 years of age, from Brighton, Colorado.
Okay, he's kicking at this ball two rails and trying to sneak in behind us. Oh, it's a good shot.
Come on, baby.
It's a good shot.
Oh, is that a beautiful shot. He could not have done it better.
No, he snookered Mike Siegel behind the three ball.
Jack talking about snookering Siegel. By that, he means he did not leave Siegel with a shot at the object ball being the ball with the lowest number currently on the table, that being the two. But the problem for Siegel is he is buried behind that bright red ball in the foreground.
Hey, he's going to kick behind the three ball and try to make a good solid hit on this two ball.
Oh, and he flirts with dumping the nine ball in that
nice
side
way to
pocket.
Start.
Yeah, he's left Danny with a very difficult. Hey, Mike's trying to hit behind the three ball in order to make the two. He's made a very good solid hit here. Almost makes the nine here. This is a very long straight shot for Danny. He just drilled it right on in. He's still got to contend with the 4-8 ball combination here, Phil. Danny's going to attempt to make the 4-8 combination.
Back in 1984, it was this man on the table now who ran away with the Las Vegas Open Corner Pockets Championship. Same year, he won the McDermott Masters. Correction, he finished second in the McDermott Masters. There's a combination, the eight ball diving into the corner pocket. Danny's most current victory came this past year at the Disneyland Mixed Nine Ball Open.
Danny's a very seasoned veteran player, even though he's a very young man. He's been at this quite a few years. He's let this ball get a little bit too straight. He's going to pull back a little bit to the center of the table so he can shoot the six in the corner and play position on the seven. These players are always playing two or three balls in advance here. Oh, he's got a real problem here. He's allowed this ball to get too straight in.
What do you mean when you say playing the next two or three balls in advance?
Well, they must know where they're going to be going two or three balls down the road to successfully clean the table, to run completely out. Now what he's done, he's allowed himself to get too straight in on the six, too easier shot, and he doesn't have an angle to be able to get to the other side of the table where the seven is laying up against the rail. He's got to pull this ball straight back. He's going to have to pull this ball straight back. One of the big problems here, the seven ball is really frozen to the rail, which makes it quite difficult to go through this. He's going to be following this ball here. He's going to follow this ball and try to come out of their two rails. This cue ball is too straight in. He's got to force this ball. He's trying to shoot this ball into like a quarter of the pockets that are directly into the center of the pocket to create an angle. Okay, Mike's going to kind of bring his ball up in around the nine. Mike hasn't made a very good shot here. This is a very difficult shot Mike's left himself. When these balls are this close to this seven ball so close to the rail, they have a tendency to catch the lip of the side pocket as they run up the rail. The lip actually, oh, it's a great shot, great shot.
Taking advantage of a mistake on the part of Danny Medina, has walked away with game one of this elimination round semifinal from Resorts International. In this elimination round semifinal action, Siegel out in front of Danny Medina by a count of 1-0, and it is Mike Siegel who has control here of the break in game two.
Okay, Phil, he's going to have to make sure that he keeps this ball in the center of the table. Now remember, he's got to try to keep this ball, cue ball, in the center of the table. He doesn't want to give his opponent the cue ball in hand.
He will leave the table open for Medina.
Yeah, Danny's, these balls are laying good for Danny.
Siegel's Siegel, as he approached his seat on that break, had his palms outstretched as if to say, I can't break him any better than that.
Now, the ball scattered real well, just nothing fell in the hole. He has a problem here. Danny has a problem. It's 2-6. The two balls down at the opposite end of the table. He doesn't really have much of an angle to pull this ball back. I look to follow his ball down and around two rails. This table is playing real tough. These pockets are really tight. A lot of these balls are jumping right out on us. That's Jeannie Beloukas there, Phil. She's the greatest player, woman player that's ever lived.
Boy, her list of accomplishments would take hours and hours to document.
She's won every female tournament that's ever been held in the last 10 years. And Danny looks like he's a little bit sewed up behind his five ball.
In the wind, you heard, was the exasperation of Mike Siegel.
Hey, Danny's going to try to jump over this five ball. He's actually going to jump completely over this five ball in order to pocket the one. It's a great
nailed
shot.
It. And scratched in the process.
Are they rolling?
He made a great shot. Unfortunately, he was not rewarded.
Oh, just give it.
He's looking. Danny's looking to jump this ball here in order to pocket the one. He's going to look to jump completely over the five ball. See the ball just completely leave the table, Phil.
Siegel sneaks the two ball into the corner and in the process leaves himself with a nice run at number three ball.
The balls are laying real good for Siegel right now.
I'm sort of partial to Mike Siegel, Jack, in that he, like myself, is a southpaw.
Yeah, he is the best left-handed player in the world today.
You haven't seen me play.
Well, that's true. Maybe I'll get an opportunity before this is over. Well, he may have...
Am I snookered?
He may have snookered himself here.
What he said to himself as he walked around. He said, am I snookered?
Must not be. Let's look how you hit the ball. Oh, that's a good shot. Watch out. This ball's rolling. This ball's rolling.
I could reach. Oh, God.
This is a very difficult shot. Anytime you get real close to this rail where you can't hit the full cue ball, it causes tremendous problems. It's a good shot. He still left himself tough.
Now he's got the eight ball just up against that end rail.
Yeah, he's going to have to whack this ball. This ball's going to run up and down. He's going to shoot right-handed now, Bill. He's switch hitting for us. That's a great shot.
That's unbelievable, huh?
Siegel to take a 2-0 lead.
That's a good shot.
The whales, man, the whales are like boiling in the coffee. A little bit, that looked like it.
Al Siegel is out quickly to a 2-0 lead over Danny Medina. We'll be back to Resorts International with more Nine Ball Championship Pool in just a moment.
good shot. Danny's made a good shot here. Yeah, I think he's actually gotten too close to this ball, Phil.
Can he shave it into that side pocket?
I think he can, but the trouble is he's going to have to turn his cue ball loose, which he doesn't really want to do. He may wind up going into this 8 or 9 here. He's really going to have to cut this ball real thin. He's got room. He can cut it in and just...
8 ball also went.
He got a little lucky there. The players don't like to go into other balls with the cue balls because you don't really know where you're going to be hitting this ball. So he's got to hit this ball wafer thin. It just goes right into the hole.
Now he's looking to run the 3 up into the corner and successfully negotiates it.
Danny's got a tough shot here because he's got to hit this ball and he's got to get it out close to the center of the table so he can... just took the short side. All he wants to make sure is that he can hit the ball. He's not too interested. It doesn't seem like he's getting close to the ball itself. So now he just jumped right up off that ball there, Phil. See, this ball is hit real solid.
Now Medina, throughout this tournament, Jack, has exhibited pretty much one single shot, and that's... go after the ball.
Yeah, I had my eye on him.
Yeah, he just shoots straight and he just shoots to play and he shoots to win.
Does not seem to have a, I suppose, what one would refer to as a finesse shot.
No, it's basically he's just a straight shooting 9 ball player. His technique, and I guess just because he's basically a young player, young at the sport, he just wants to be able to shoot and hit the ball. Mike's played safe here.
Jack, if you had this shot, what would you try and do?
I'd go borrow some money. He's going to look to nip this ball in, if he possibly can. He's going to kick off the back rail and try to kick this ball in. No. I think they're hearing me. It's a good shot. See, he's really throws his cue ball up against the rail, which really causes some problems for striking the object ball. He's only got 1/8 of this cue ball to hit here, Phil. Plus, he's got a long ways to go. To it, all you do is stay down on the ball and hit it and follow through. It's going to draw this ball back just a little bit to be able to get this. It's a good shot.
Perfect position on the 9 ball. Single waste this time at all and going after the game winner. 9 ball bangs into the back of the corner pocket, and game 10 is over. It is Siegel 6, Medina 4. We'll be back in a moment. For the 3rd Annual Resorts International 9 Ball Championships, this semifinal match featuring Mike Siegel of Maryland versus Danny Medina of Brighton, Colorado. It is Siegel out in front, 6-4. First player to reach 9 will advance. Player on the short end of this score
play one
will be eliminated in the chase for the top prize of $40,000.
No, man.
unable to sink a ball in the break, gives the table to Medina, but Medina has a tough situation out there with the 1-3 ball kissed up against one another.
He doesn't have a makeable shot, Phil. He's just going to have to look to duck and play safe. Probably leave the one down at that end of the table and just bring his cue ball all the way back down around the 9-ball area.
Medina, who lost earlier in this tournament to Jose Garcia of Island, New Jersey. So for Medina, this is a must-win situation.
I tell you, showing a lot of character here for a young, relatively inexperienced tournament player. He has a lot of years to go in this industry.
Now he's taking a while looking this shot over.
He's just going to look to play safe. He's going to look to nip the ball and get the cue ball back down to the other end of the table. Oh, he made it. Look at this.
And as you suggested, Jack, that ball dropping for him, the 3-ball was simply a bonus as he tried to work that cue ball back to the long end of the table.
But that might have been a surprise he didn't really want. Now he's got himself into deeper turmoil here.
The mouth of that corner pocket and would not fall.
These balls are laying real good now. Hey, Phil, he's trying to hit this ball real solid and just stay in line for the two up by the side pocket. These players actually, they don't like actually aim at the pocket. They aim at percentages of the pocket, a half a pocket, a quarter of a pocket, in order to create angles that don't exist there in order to get positioned for the next ball. Mike has created himself a problem here.
Why don't I look at that? It could play the 9. Why don't I even look at that?
Phil, Mike's got himself a real problem here. He's got this 4-ball froze up against the rail by the lip of the side pocket. Right here is his real problem. He's trying to figure out how to play around that. Even though the 2 and the 3 are both hanging in the pocket, the 4 is a very difficult shot. He's going to have to either try to break this 4 away from the rail.
But as we have talked about throughout the telecast, Jack, it is not only important to work on the object ball, but you've got to work that cue ball in position to go after the next object ball.
Right now he's playing 4 or 5 balls ahead of the ball that he's actually shooting at. This is probably the worst spot a ball can get on the table.
Well, he's looking at the number 4 ball, and yet his object ball at this point is the number 2 ball to be followed by the number 3 ball.
And ironically, his next ball in line is hung up in attempting to bank this 4 ball here. That's what he's going to do. He's going to try to bank the 4 into the side pocket here, Phil. It's what you call 9 ball here.
Give me something.
Free swinging 9 ball.
And he snookered himself.
He may be able to spin right around this ball here. Bill, he's going to bank this ball in the side pocket with a real powerful hard stroke to force it right into the side pocket. Here he's got to kick at this ball. He's got to be careful. Even if he makes it, he makes snooker himself behind the sevens. He's got to hit this ball pretty slow. He's got himself behind the seven ball. He's got to be real careful here and not to get himself behind the seven ball when he's kicking at this ball. And he's got himself in a real problem. He's got to kind of spin this ball around the seven to even hit it. This is his cue ball here. He's got to spin this ball into here and try to hit it, kick off this way, and actually try to kick the ball into the corner pocket. But there again, he's got to make sure he kicks it in hard enough. Oh, he missed it altogether. Danny Medina will now receive the cue ball in hand. He placed it anywhere on the table.
Down as soon as I hit it. Huh? It did. As soon as I hit a flat ball, as soon as I hit it, went right.
Thank you. Don't mess this one up.
Hey, you heard Danny Medina say to himself, don't mess this one up.
Yeah, this is a big opportunity for Devaney. He can get back into the hunt here. Remember, the breaking player has the best of it. The guy at the table is the favorite, regardless of what the score is. He's left himself a little bit of a shot here.
Pinches the nine ball, down it goes. And a moment ago, it looked as if Siegel might take a 7-4 lead. Instead, it's a two-game swing for Medina. He now trails by one. It's Siegel 6. Medina 5. We'll be back to Atlantic City in a moment. Championships, and what a match we have underway. It is Mike Siegel and Danny Medina, and it is Siegel who leads this match. 6-5. Well, a very pleasant good evening to each and every one of you. I'm Phil Stone, along with Jack Johnston, and my extreme right is a man who you have known in the billiard world for many, many years, Steve Mizera. Steve,
how are you, Phil?
Doing Jack? Just fine. One heck of a match tonight.
Yes, it is. Danny's first time in front of the cameras, in front of the lights, and he's having problems, and so is Mike. What's happening is the cloth is basically a true pool table cloth. It was made for the craps, befitting Resorts International, and it's a little slow.
Medina,
so they're having problems.
Medina with a ball to fall off the break. What is the difference in the felt, Steve?
It's very low. It's very thick, and it's very slow. I've never seen a cloth this slow, but as you can tell, both players are having problems. That's why the matches are basically taking so long here.
Steve, I got a question to ask. How can a school teacher wind up being one of the best pool players that ever lived?
I was a pool player before I was a school teacher, Jack.
Oh, okay. I just never had a school teacher like that before.
My mother always wanted me to go to college, so I went to college, had a steady job at teacher school for 13 years, and I was offered a deal I couldn't refuse, and I took it.
Now Danny Medina on the short end of a 6-5 score, first player to reach 9 games, will win this elimination round match.
Steve, you're now representing Light Bear.
Yes, I am.
Medina. One ball into the side pocket, and he buries a few balls.
Danny made a real good shot here. He just scratched, just followed the ball all the way in.
Score's going to be 7-5 in a few minutes.
Here, Danny's kicking at the one ball. It's a good, solid hit.
Very unlucky hit it full in the face. That's the only way he could miss it.
And Mike's going to take a shortcut here now.
Combination on the nine ball, and this game is
who
over.
Who is he? No luck in this game.
Mike just said, who is he? He's probably the greatest player alive today.
Dead center?
Steve, is it tough to watch some of the younger fellows come up now and to take the spot that you held for so many years?
I wish I was out there, Phil.
Yeah.
You know, it, It hurts a little bit to see, but
right. The only thing is, I
you know, the swing gets slower in golf, the stroke gets a little jumpier in pool, and you know, that happens to everybody.
Has it been tough for you to accept that?
Yeah.
No. Why? I haven't accepted it yet. I haven't reached my prime. Are you kidding? I'll be out there for another 10 years.
Well, that's good
Watch
to hear.
Break.
Steve, what do you think, in your opinion, is the most important shot playing nine ball?
Make the nine.
Make the nine.
That's it.
Preferably on the break.
The break is the break is very important, Jack. The shot after the break, if a good player like Mike gets a shot, it's history. The game is over. If you don't get a shot after the break, you lose. It's as simple as that. That's why we had 356 players here competing this week. It's you could call it a game of chance. With just a little bit,
shot here.
Little bit of skill involved.
A little bit more than a little bit of skill.
Yeah.
Siegel in control of the table. He has a 7-5 lead over Medina in this semifinal elimination round match. There's a man who lost earlier in this tournament to Jose Garcia.
These balls are laying real well.
Mike likes to talk to himself when he plays. It relaxes him.
Mike stays down real good over this ball. Body doesn't move hardly at all.
Nice reverse English on the cue ball. Backs it up and gives him a superb shot on the six ball.
Going to follow this ball forward and just try to get where he can hit the seven. Good shot here.
Oh,
what a powerful stroke.
He got in between the rock and the hard place here. He has to cut it in soft, hold it up the eight.
A real tough shot here. He's got to roll this ball.
Missed it.
A bit too thin. And he opens the table up for Medina.
Can't see where to aim it. It's all good on that. I don't know where to aim at the shot.
What a time to give Medina the table.
In the last couple of games,
played the six and
Mike
just got straight on the seven.
Just literally giving the games away.
As I was sitting over by the side there, Phil and Jack, Mike came over to us and he said that the lights are shining so brightly on the balls that he can't see the spot to hit the cue ball. Nick said the same thing. And I guess he's having a lot of problems here. Danny's back in the match.
Boy, I should say. Nine ball goes down, and Medina has once more crept to within one of the leader, Mike Siegel. So it will be Medina in line to break the 14th game of this elimination match. Stone, along with Jack Johnston, and our guest commentator, Steve Mizorak, has joined us for the tail end of this elimination round semifinal.
Phil, Jack said before that the break is very powerful. Mike is sitting in a chair, he may not get up. Danny could very possibly run three racks if he gets any luck whatsoever.
You see this ball just jump. The cue ball just jumps.
And look where the nine ball sits.
He's going to bank this one ball into the side pocket.
Right. He hit him so hard. Watch the nine going towards the hole. He gets kissed out by the two. Okay, but he's got no position for the one. And he might have to bank the one into the nine here.
That was the question I was going to ask. Could he possibly run a combination on the nine?
No. He's banking it cross-side. He should play safe.
There it is.
He got lucky. He got lucky. Yeah. Look at here. Look at what happened here.
Mother.
I think
look what happened. He's safe. I mean, he's liable to jump right over this ball. If it's the 7, he'll jump over it. If it's the 6, he can't jump over it. It's too close. Danny's right in the thick of the match here.
One thing that Jack and I have commented throughout the telecast and this tournament, Steve, is the fact that nobody has really taken control of the table and run 3 or 4 racks.
Well, the break is, look at him, he's trying
to jump
over. Danny's
jumped his ball.
He's a little bit too close to the 6. But he only has to jump about half of the ball, so that gives him a little bit of a break. If you notice, there's a short cue under the table. Danny's not reaching for it, and that's a jump cue. Danny's going to try to jump with his own cue.
Look at his eyes.
He's trying to jump right over this. He's able to hit the 6 ball. That's the only one I'm worried about.
This ball's going to completely leave the table in here.
It's a good shot. And what a shot it was for Danny Medina.
See, Danny's going to try to take and strike down on this ball and jump completely over the 7 ball. And here it comes.
A lot of people think, Jack, that you have to hit under the ball to make a jump. You hit on top of the ball and shoot it into the slate and into the cloth, and that makes a jump.
So the actual point of contact is more to the top of the ball, Steve?
Right, right. Don't try it in your home table. Go to somebody else's place to do it.
Danny's got a real problem here. He's going to have to...
He's going to try to billiard a 9 then, I believe.
He's a freewheeling 9
yes,
ball player,
is.
Would you say he is?
He's what we call a wide-open player.
We were talking earlier in the match, Steve Mizorak, that Danny seems to have one stroke, and that is go for the gold.
That's it.
It looked like he was going to jack up and just try to play the billiard. Now he's going to whack the 4 in.
Well, he's going to try to cut it. And if he undercuts it, he's going to make the 4 in off the 9. Doesn't look like he's playing the billiard, no.
He's going to swing at it.
He missed the whole ball.
You may get a little lucky here.
Yeah, real lucky.
He left a 4-6.
Missed the whole ball.
Missed the whole ball completely, he said, as he walked back to the chair. Danny's a little nervous, and rightly so. It's a lot of money. $40,000 is riding.
He's getting a little lucky here.
Steve, in all the years you have been playing this game of pool, what's the biggest top prize you have walked away with? Can you recall it?
$12,000. This is the biggest.
It's a good shot. He's made a good shot here.
The biggest first prize ever given away in a billiard.
Boy, oh boy.
And how many years has it been for you?
Playing? Tournament competition? 25.
And $12,000's the top prize.
That's it.
Wow, that should let all of you at home know just how important this tournament is to these competitors.
I remember I was top money winner a couple of years, and I made $18,000.
And that was $18,000 total?
Yeah. That wouldn't get me from Brooklyn to Manhattan today.
Certainly not if you stop for a play.
No.
Mike's got to cut this ball real thin. He's got himself in somewhat of a predicament here because this ball is pretty straight in here. He's trying to follow this ball, and he doesn't have much of a pocket to work with.
He doesn't have to worry about scratching. He can hit it as hard as he wants.
He's made a good shot here. This ball's going to die on him a little bit, though.
Off the yellow.
Off the resort sign, he said. They call it the yellow.
Steve, you think this $40,000 is making these pockets a little smaller?
Yes, definitely. Absolutely so.
Seven balls safely down in excellent position to win his eighth game of this match.
If I was to pick a guy to win from all the guys left, you see him right here on the table, just won the eighth game.
So as the crowd looks on here at Resorts International, it is Mike Siegel out in front by two over the pride and joy of Brighton, Colorado. Resorts International is the place to be. It is Mike Siegel and Danny Medina in the elimination round semifinals. And Siegel comfortably out in front.
He's
by
not,
a score of 8-6.
Phil, he's not too comfortably out. As Danny only needs three games and needs one shot at the table. He could run three games very simple.
Well, with one problem, though, Steve, and that is we have not seen a player yet run three tables.
I did. When I was playing somebody, they did it on me, Phil.
Watch this.
What's a cue ball
He's going to shatter these balls. As far as he's concerned, this is for the whole tournament.
I tell you what, rather than watch the white ball go sometimes, Mike bows his cue every time.
These balls are...
Watch his cue. Watch the bow on the cue.
Right.
See the bow on the cue? Mike has never shattered a shaft, but I know he shattered a couple of one balls.
Well, Medina may not get a shot at this table.
No, Mike's... The table's laying real good now. Mike's going to just basically shoot and stop here.
If I was a betting man, which I am, the 21 table could tell you that. I don't think Danny will get out of the chair except to shake Mike's hand.
Mike's going to play position to make the 5-9 combination. Just got to whip this ball down to the other end of the table, and he's out.
Got to worry about scratching. It's the only thing.
He made a good shot here.
He protected highly against the scratch. He hit the second diamond on the rail. He wanted to get a little bit straighter.
He's wound up with a tough shot.
But I think he can handle this jack.
He could end this match right here with a 5-9 combination.
Good thing about this, if he does miss, the cue ball's going to be at the other end of the table.
And I think he's going to roll it and play safe if he does miss and snooker him between behind the 6 and the 7 or 7 and the 8 or whatever it is.
Danny Medina has been eliminated from the tournament.
Watch him. I think he's going to win it. I think he's going to win it. Mike's wife giving him congratulations.
Mike Siegel, the winner. And this elimination round semifinal. Welcome back to Resorts International, everybody. I'm Phil Stone, along with Jax Johnson, and we're standing with the winner, Mike Siegel, over Danny Medina. And Mike, I know earlier in this tournament, you played one day 24 consecutive hours. Has
yes,
it caught up with
right.
you yet?
Yes. I mean, I played today my one match. I'm glad it's over. I was a little, I felt good, but under the circumstances, my body's a little tired. So I get to sleep now, and tomorrow, play about 6 o'clock, I'll come out real strong tomorrow.
Mike. When we were in the booth, Steve Misurek said you were the best player in the world today. I have one question.
What?
Who plays better, you or Paul Newman?
Paul Newman definitely plays better than me. Tom Cruise is a close second.
Well, you got to like your position right now, Mike. You have made it now, and you're really moving towards that prize of $40,000. And I wonder if those pockets get a little bit smaller when you think about that money.
Yeah, they sure do. I mean, I've been through this many times before. I've won a lot of titles, and I just recently I won a big tournament. And... you know, the guys that are going to run out under the pressure are the ones that are going to win. I mean, the table starts to look a little bit smaller, but if you're used to it, it's just like those making those five-foot putts for the big money.
Congratulations on a job well done.
Thank you very much.
Mike Siegel, the winner over Danny Medina. For Jack Johnston, I'm Phil Stone. Thanks for joining us here at Resorts International, the 9-Ball Championship. So long, everybody.